I'm on a mission to live a more sustainable life. So far, I've looked at the future of my fridge, but now it's time to dig a little bit deeper and look specifically at meat.
It looks like meat, and apparently it tastes like meat, but instead of grazing open pastures, this stuff was grown in a lab. Cultured meat could be produced with up to 96% lower greenhouse gas emissions, 45% less use of energy, 99% lower land use, and 96% less water than making conventional meat. The world's first cultured burger was created here back in 2013, and they are changing the shape of the future.
First, a small biopsy is taken from the muscle of an animal. In the case of our hamburger, it's a cow. Technicians will then dissect the tissue and extract myosatellite cells, which are muscle stem cells. These are cultured by placing them in a growth solution containing amino acids and carbohydrates, and are allowed to grow just as they would inside an animal. The trillions of newly grown muscle cells naturally merge to form myotubes, tiny muscle fibres, which are then placed in a ring of gel that acts a bit like scaffolding for the developing tissue. The muscle cells' natural inclination to contract causes them to start putting on bulk and will eventually grow into small fibrous strands that can be layered together and moulded into a hamburger.
There are some people who will find the idea of making meat in a laboratory a little bit Frankenstein, like too sci-fi for them to handle.
Yeah.
What do you think to that?
Yeah, of course, it's totally new, so people will think different things than us now here. Uh-huh. So yeah, I think they just need to try it and to see if they like it. It's like real meat.
Has anyone tasted it?
Yeah, a few people.
How expensive was one of those burgers? That must have been the most expensive burger ever made.
Yeah, 250,000 euros for one hamburger. And like maybe 6-7 people taste from it.
250,000 euros for one burger and 7 people got to try it.
Yeah, around that. So.
Do they have ketchup? Tomato sauce, I'm joking.
It was on a hamburger. They made a hamburger on bread. And
did they? Does the process require genetic modification at all?
No. We don't do any genetic modification.
Okay.
We just want to have the stem cell from the muscle and we let it do what it can do and that's it.
Wow. Thank you so much for letting us see this.
Yeah, no problem.
Would you eat it?
Yeah.
Would you?
Well, cultured meat truly is fascinating, but part of me wonders if it's ethical. We talked to Professor Julian Savulescu about his paper on this.
There are a number of problems currently with in vitro meat. Firstly, the cost. It's about 9 times more expensive at the moment. Secondly, there's safety. The meat has to be grown from stem cells on a feeder layer, and theoretically there are problems with infection. It could also change the way we view animals and our relationship with animals. It could instrumentalize further the view that animals are just there to produce meat. And lastly, philosophically, it raises this deep issue that it will radically reduce the number of animals. There won't be 20 billion domesticated animals, there'll be far fewer. It could, you know, further industrialise the whole process of meat production, a little bit like the pharmaceutical industry has industrialised the production of medicinal substances. It could also have massive advantages to climate change and the use of resources. It could be much more efficient than factory farming. And thirdly, it could be much better for human beings. Because it's more efficient, you could feed more humans and potentially you could make the product much healthier than current meat alternatives.
Well, that certainly gives us some food for thought as to what the future of lab-grown meat might look like. Here, they've just got a tiny hamburger patty that I didn't get to try, but does it stop there?
The Next Nature Network in Amsterdam have done a lot of research into this, so much so they've even written a cultured meat cookbook. I don't know how I feel about this yet, but I'm going to find out. You have taken that idea of cultured meat and you've gone that one step further. And you're thinking about the possibilities. What could that mean in the future?
Quite deliberately, indeed, because when I stepped into this space, I saw scientists working on, well, growing meat without having to slaughter an animal, and it's more sustainable, more animal friendly. It's promising, but they were making the same burgers and sausage that we already know.
This here in front of us,
this is the result of the
Meet the Future project. Talk me through some of these. I'm going to start with this one, and
yes,
this is the knitted meat.
Indeed, the knitted meat. If it's too difficult to 3D print an entire steak, but you could make thin threads, then yeah, you might have this future habit in the kitchen that you are knitting the meat. And then you can knit your steak.
I want to talk about these two here. So I
yes.
think this is supposed to be bone.
Well, here we envision that you would 3D print a bone marrow egg, which then also you put in a soup and it gives this nice meaty flavor to your soup. This one is similar but also different. These are the bone utensils. If you eat meat, then you know some to eat from the bone. It's this primitive feeling of eating meat.
Okay,
so it has this kind
it.
Of,
What's the idea behind this?
These are the celebrity cubes. So here the idea is that yes, you can make meat from cells of a pig, a chicken, a cow, okay. But human cells, you can, technically you can do it. So if Justin Bieber, Lady Gaga, Usain Bolt, if they're willing to donate some cells, we could grow them into a nice snack.
That's terrifying, the thought that actually, technically, we could do that.
Yes.
You could culture human meat.
Yes, because it has this association with cannibalism.
Yeah.
And that we don't want to go there.
No.
But then again, you're not hurting anyone. You just take a few cells and then it grows.
Mm-hmm.
So I think also this shows that the new technology forces us to take our position again, to have a new philosophical position towards, what's the ethics? What's the new morality with the new technology?
But perhaps there's a much simpler solution. I'm visiting the Centre of Alternative Technology in Wales to meet Anne Owen and discuss meat alternatives. Do you think for us to live a sustainable future, we have to cut meat out?
Maybe we are eating too much meat. Maybe we don't need to stop eating meat altogether, but we can just eat less meat.
Okay.
A little bit like in the 50s, where meat was a treat and you had it for a Sunday roast.
Yeah. You love beans.
Yes.
Why? Why are they a great alternative to meat?
Because they are so versatile. I mean, look at it.
On a nutritious level as well.
Yes.
So they are high in protein, but also fibre.
Yes.
So they will help fill you up.
And they're a good source of carbs, a good source of complex carbohydrates.
Okay. And what about growing them? Is that something that anyone can do?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah?
Easy peasy.
Well, why? Could I do it?
Because,
In a windowsill, could I grow them?
Yes, you can grow them. Because there are varieties that stay very short, and you've got varieties that will go up a wall. So you take your pick, you know.
Versatile, and there's going to be a bean out there for you.
Absolutely.
What do we have here?
Well, it looks like we've got a hummus, which is most likely made from fava beans.
Fava bean hummus, okay. And this, I think, is a guacamole made out of peas.
Yes, not your usual mushy peas, no.
Okay, right, I'm going to taste this, see how it is. Very good.
And what you've got here is a chili with what looks like butter beans, but it's served on a bed of quinoa. Now, this quinoa is also grown here in the UK. If you're thinking of eating sustainably and you're going to cut out meat because you want to eat more sustainably, then it's a good idea to also become a little bit of a locavore, which means that you can try and eat local.
A what?
Locavore.
A locavore. What is this one here?
Well, that is a pudding. It's a chocolate mousse.
Yeah.
And the fluffiness in there has been created by using the cooking water of the borlotti bean.
That's really good. Wow, so this is a pudding that's quite high in protein as well then in that case.
Yeah, and the odd calorie I would imagine.
Yeah. If I could replace all the meat in my diet with that chocolate pudding, I'd be happy. That's my favourite alternative so far.
There you go, we've won you over.
To find out more about living sustainably, you can watch the rest of the videos in this series. And don't forget to subscribe.